Maya talk. Thank you, Dr. Raman. Share my screen, please.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Vasudha and the organizers for this opportunity. Wonderful talks today, the whole Sunday morning. I enjoyed it a lot. So the last session, I'm going to talk to you about advances in supportive care for children. A brief background, supportive care in children is not given as much attention as it is given in adults. Pharma companies are not interested in doing trials in children because it's not profitable. And children are not the same as adults. Their needs and morbidities are different from adults. And also, I feel that supportive care in LMICs are different from supportive care needs in high-income countries. And we are very proud that, you know, majority of supportive care literature and research has come from India. And today I'll be focusing almost a majority of my talk on studies from India and how it's impacted the lives of our patients. So there are various components of supportive care, and this is a big list, starting from chemotherapy-induced nausea, vomiting, fatigue, mucositis, pain, antibiotic prophylaxis, nutrition, transfusions. So I try to cover as much as possible in the next half an hour. So my first, I would like to focus on chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. As high as 30 to 50% in studies, on some studies up to 70% of children who receive moderate or highly immunogenic chemotherapy develop nausea or vomiting, and majority of pediatric patients either receive moderate or highly immunogenic chemotherapy. It is very difficult to assess nausea and vomiting in children, especially nausea, because a young child cannot say he's nauseated or cannot, you know, tell what is the degree of nausea. And as I said, there's limited research in children, but it's improving. It takes about a decade before a drug is introduced in adults before it comes to children. For example, apripiprant and fosaprepitant were introduced in the late 2000, but it took almost a decade for it to be used in children. So first, I'd like to talk to you about CINV prophylaxis. That is, you give this drug before the child gets chemotherapy to prevent vomiting. So there are two major guidelines, the ASCO guidelines and the Children's Oncology Group guidelines. ASCO recommends, and also COG recommends, a three-drug combination for highly immunogenic chemotherapy. This combination includes a 5-HT3 antagonist like ondansetron or palnocetron with DEXA and apripiprant or fosaprepitant. COG has not yet introduced fosaprepitant. And for moderately immunogenic chemotherapy, the recommendation is two-drug combination, but I would err on the side of a three-drug combination because our own studies have shown that a three-drug works better than a two-drug in a moderately immunogenic chemotherapy. And possibly over the coming years, this guidelines will be updated. There are certain definitions which everybody needs to know when we are talking about CINV studies. The first is definition of acute phase of vomiting, which is nothing but the 24 hours from the end of the chemotherapy block. So somebody is getting cyclophosphamide 24 hours after the finishing of cyclophosphamide. If the patient vomits, that is acute phase of vomiting. Delayed is another, that is up to 120 hours from the acute phase, that is up to 5 days. And the overall period is nothing but the acute and delayed phase combined together. If somebody is getting a 5-day chemotherapy like IE, the acute phase is till day 6, that is 24 hours from the last dose of chemotherapy, and the delayed phase continues for another 5 days from the last dose of chemotherapy. The two major studies for CINV in children came around at the same time in 2015 from Dr. Bakshi, and the other one was in Lancet Oncology by Novartis, which was by Kang. And both looked at adding apripiprant to the standard ondansetron and dexamethasone block. And they showed that these drugs were much more effective when compared to the two-drug placebo combination. Dr. Bakshi's study showed a 22% control in the total phase, whereas Kang showed almost 40%. That is, there was almost a doubling of control of CINV, with apripiprant. So, but the problem with apripiprant was that the pediatric apripiprant doses are not available in India. That is, we don't have the solutions, and the adult doses are only recommended for children above 12 years. So therefore, we decided to do a study of using fosaprepitant, which is extensively used in adults, to replace apripiprant. And FDA had actually approved fosaprepitant by the time we finished the study, but this approval was not based on any randomized trial. And as I said, there was no study, prospective study on the safety and efficacy of fosaprepitant in children. Fosaprepitant is an IV preparation and is a prodrug of apripiprant. The biggest advantage of fosaprepitant is that it can be given as a single dose versus a three-day dose of oral apripiprant. So you have better compliance. The children already have an IV line when they're getting chemotherapy. Also, it's useful in children who are vomiting because you give a apripiprant tablet, the child might vomit. And at least in US, it's cheaper to use fosaprepitant than aprepitant. This is not true in India because the price is almost similar for both aprepitant and fosaprepitant. So he went on to compare fosaprepitant against a placebo to control CIDP in children. So the study, we used a normal saline as a placebo, and we used the doses of ondansetron and dexamethasone, which had already been used by Dr. Bakshi, and we observed for 48 hours after the last dose of chemotherapy. So the trial had 82 patients in the placebo arm and 81 patients in the fosaprepitant arm. The patients were balanced. The median age was about 5 to 6 years, and median weight was 18 in the fosaprepitant arm. Almost two-thirds of the patient had prior exposure to chemotherapy. Majority had single-line chemotherapy. And about 16 to 18% had a central line. I'll come to this, why is central line important? The most common diagnosis was leukemia and lymphoma followed by bone tumors, and therefore the chemotherapies are also similar, ABVD or cyclophosphamide. There are two emetogenicity scales used, that is the NCCN and the pediatric scale. The only difference is that the pediatric scale takes a cyclophosphamide dose more than 1 g/m² and actinomycete is highly emetogenic, whereas NCCN takes it moderately emetogenic. So when we use the pediatric scale, majority of our patients in both the arms, 65% in FOSA arm and 74% in the placebo arm, received highly emetogenic chemotherapy, whereas it was reversed in the NCCN scale. These are the results, and as you can see, overall 70% of our patients in the FOSA arm and 41% in the two drug arm, this placebo arm, had control. And this was also significant in the acute phase and delayed phase. About 4% of patients in the FOSA arm needed rescue antiemetics because they vomited, and 20 in the placebo arm required rescue antiemetics. There were no adverse events associated with the use of fosaprepitant. And this is, as I said, FOSA works in moderately emetogenic chemotherapy and as well as in highly emetogenic chemotherapy. That's why I said probably COG and ASCO need to change their guideline to include a three-drug regimen for moderately emetogenic chemotherapy patients. This is a busy slide, but all it shows that it's almost similar when you compare FOSA with placebo in children. So there was no increased adverse events in children with use of fosaprepitant. So our study, this study was one of the studies which showed the highest CR rates ever reported with any CIMB prophylaxis, much higher than what has been reported with fosaprepitant also. There were certain differences in our study. FDA recommends a dose of fosaprepitant of 5 mg/kg over 60 minutes in children up to 2 years. And 4 mg/kg up to over 60 minutes in children up between 2 to 12 years. We used a dose of 3 mg/kg given over 30 minutes. The maximum dose is always 150 mg because when we did the study, FDA had not come out with their doses, and our results with 3 mg/kg over 30 minutes were quite good as well. And FDA recommends using aprepitant, that is oral aprepitant with fosaprepitant, on day 2 and day 3, which we didn't use. And I don't think so, we need to give aprepitant when you're using fosaprepitant. The dose of dexa recommended by the FDA and other guidelines are quite high. And we feel that, you know, we can use half the dose. And anyway, when you're using fosaprepitant or aprepitant, you need to reduce the dose of dexa by 50% because of the interaction. We also used a slightly higher maintenance dose of ondansetron. The FDA recommends actually to use central venous catheter when you're giving fosaprepitant because there you can get phlebitis, but we didn't see this. So we don't recommend using a CV, central venous access, when using fosaprepitant. And also FDA says that there's a significant interaction between chemotherapy drugs like cyclophosphamide, ifosfamide, vinblastine, vincristine when you're using fosaprepitant. So don't use FOSA with these chemo. We would disagree. There's a lot of evidence both from adult studies and now from pediatric studies, which shows that you don't need to modify doses. There's no increased toxicity. These are all preclinical studies, but they do not actually translate to toxicities in the patient. We did not assess nausea in our study. So to conclude, FOSA should become the standard of care for CIMB prophylaxis in children. Hot off the press, Dr. Bakshi went one step ahead. Instead of using three drugs, he added the fourth drug, that is, he bought olanzapine along with your aprepitant, dexamethasone, ondansetron. This has already been done in adults and shown to be very effective by Navri et al. And when they saw, when they added olanzapine, the overall CIMB, that is chemotherapy-induced vomiting rate control, was 64%. And the nausea control rate was also 64%. This was double the placebo. But these are still lower than what we reported with fosaprepitant. So my take would be, I won't add olanzapine as a fourth drug. I would probably go with fosaprepitant. I would use olanzapine as a drug for breakthrough vomiting, that is children who develop breakthrough vomiting, and we have a study which I'll come to later. So start with three drug and use olanzapine as a backup, because if somebody vomits in this, as per this study, another 44% will vomit. We have very limited options to treat breakthrough vomiting. Dr. Bakshi also recently published this month a study on use of apripitant in children with acute myeloid leukemia, because you can't use dexamethasone as a prophylaxis in children with AML. So you just use apripitant with ondansetron, and again, almost 60% control rate with use of apripitant and dexamethasone. It's a very important study and gives us one more drug in the control of vomiting in children with acute leukemias. This is what I've been talking all about. The best results have been seen with use of FOSSA. And Dr. Bakshi is currently doing a study comparing apripitant with fosaprepitant. So we'll know that whether they are the same or one is better than the other. Another important trial from India, this is from Rajiv Gandhi, Dr. Sandeep Jain and Dr. Gauri Kapoor. They compared palnacitron with ondansetron. I would prefer palnacitron because it's just one dose, 20 microgram per kg, unlike ondansetron, which you have to give for 2-3 days every 8 hourly. And they showed CINV control of almost 80% in their patients. This is similar to what we reported with our fosaprepitant study. And they also used a 3-drug combination of dexa, fos, and palnacitron. So I would say that we should also prefer palnacitron as a 5-HT3 antagonist in our patients. Despite adequate prophylaxis, as I said, you would still have 40 to 50% of patients vomiting with adequate, who are getting chemotherapy. So this year we published our data on olanzapine. Olanzapine is widely used in adults for controlling vomiting and as a treatment for breakthrough vomiting. And the Children's Oncology Group actually recommends use of either olanzapine or metoclopramide for treating breakthrough CINV. However, this is not backed up by any prospective evidence or any randomized controlled trial, although these are in the guidelines. Therefore, we decided to study using olanzapine and metoclopramide, the two recommended drugs, and to see which of them is effective and are there any safety issues. So this was our objective, to compare the complete response rate, that is how many of patients who have breakthrough vomiting actually do not develop further vomiting after adding these drugs. So this was the trial schema. So we arm A was olanzapine, arm B was metoclopramide, and patients were assessed for 72 hours. Olanzapine, again, the dosing of olanzapine in children is not clearly known. We used a dose of 2.5 milligram OD for children weighing 10 to 20 kgs and a dose of 5 mg OD in children weighing more than 20 kgs. This is approximately 0.14 mg per kg. We don't get olanzapine solutions or syrups in India, so we'll have to round it off to the nearest 2.5 mg. Metoclopramide was used as per the standard recommended doses. Dr. Bakshi also used a similar olanzapine dose in his upfront study of using olanzapine for preventing CINV. So coming on to the results of the study, and as you can see, almost 70% of patients in the olanzapine arm after developing vomiting did not have further episodes of vomiting after introducing the drug, compared to 39% in metoclopramide arm. And none of the patients had a grade 3 vomiting in the olanzapine arm after starting olanzapine. So patients who had grade 3 vomiting in the metoclopramide arm actually were crossed over to olanzapine arm because it was unethical to keep them vomiting. And all these patients who crossed over actually developed CR immediately after starting olanzapine. The nausea was also better with olanzapine. Almost 59% achieved CR for nausea in olanzapine arm compared to 34% with metoclopramide, and this was also statistically significant. This is very important. You know, unlike fosaprepitant, olanzapine is a toxic drug. Children tend to get drowsy. Almost 1/4 of them became drowsy. And when we stopped the drug, they all improved. Hyperglycemia is also an important feature. One child actually required insulin. So patients who are on olanzapine, kindly make sure that you check their blood sugar levels. We did not see any extrapyramidal symptoms with either use of olanzapine or metoclopramide, probably because we did not use higher doses of metoclopramide. So to conclude, olanzapine should be the drug of choice for treating breakthrough CINV in children who are receiving chemotherapy. Now, after a big discussion on CINV, I come to palliative care, which is also an important component of supportive care. We recently published our data in CRST, where we used a very low dose combination of oral cyclophosphamide and etoposide for children who have no further lines of options of treatment. And some of them actually went on to live for almost 1 to 2 years, basically worked very well in lymphomas like Hodgkin's lymphoma and bone tumors. Children with acute leukemias like AML did not do well. Ames from Dr. Bakshi's group actually did a randomized trial comparing metronomic chemotherapy with placebo, and they did not show any PFS benefit or overall survival benefit of adding metronomic chemotherapy in patients who have relapsed refractory tumors. Nutrition, another area of supportive care which is very dear to me and very dear to other people here like Dr. Maya. Malnutrition is associated with poor outcomes, and almost 40% of children who present to our hospital and cancer institute are undernourished at presentation. And this is our own data across all cancers. In ALL, if you're malnourished, your survival drops by about 12%. In non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it almost drops by 30-35%. In Hodgkin's lymphoma also, your survival drops by 8%. So across both, all leukemias, and we have seen the same with osteosarcoma and Ewing's also, your survival rates drop if you're malnourished, and probably if you can just improve the nutrition status, we can get, we can improve our survival in our patients. I'd like to thank Dr. Maya for these slides. This is a very elegant study. Nobody's going to do it in the Western world. Ready-to-use therapeutic feeds are high-caloric feeds which are used in war-torn and famine regions to feed children. Each a small 100-gram bar of RUTF has almost 500 kilocalories. So the Tata group did a randomized trial to see if RUTF can improve the body composition, reduce treatment-related morbidity and mortality, and improve quality of life in children with cancer. So they did a 1:1 randomization. The children were monitored for all your anthropometric parameters for weekly for 6 weeks and then monthly for 6 months. They made the RUTF in-house, and it is basically a simple paste containing groundnut powder, paste, milk powder, sugar, vegetable oil, and a micronutrient mix. And it was interesting that in the first 6 weeks, patients in the RUTF arm gained weight. They also had an increase in their midarm circumference and their tricep skin fold thickness. But at 3 months, this was not significant. Although numbers were higher, probably if it was a larger sample size, it would have been beneficial. The RUTF arm had also lesser treatment delays when compared to the placebo arm, which is again very important in our setting to maintain dose intensity. At 6 weeks and at 6 months follow-up, there was no significant difference in terms of febrile neutropenia, thrombocytopenia, or hospital admissions, although it was slightly lower in RUTF compared to the control arm. And patients who received RUTF had statistically better quality of life compared to patients who did not receive RUTF. So the key messages in the study is that RUTF is very useful in managing severe acute malnutrition in children with cancer. It increases weight, improves quality of life, and reduces toxicity. The main limitations of use RUTF is it's expensive, and you have to use it only for short term, and you cannot replace your normal diet for RUTF. Another study from PGH Chandigarh, done by Siddharth and Dr. Amita, it was a randomized trial to see whether using an algorithmic approach, that is a standard approach for treating malnutrition, helps patients with cancer. So they divided children into three groups, that is severely wasted, wasted between -3 to -2 Z-score with a midarm circumference of 5th centile, and patients who are normal or obese. And they decided whether to feed them or put a rice tube or to give them, total parental nutrition. So the study arm was the arm where the patients followed the algorithmic approach, and about 16% in the study arm and 24% in the control arm had wasting. And majority of patients in both the arms had midarm circumference less than 5th centile. So at the end of 3 months, the patients in the algorithmic approach actually did gain weight, almost a kilo, but this was not significant. But the gain in midarm circumference, which is about 1 point, this correlates with the gain in muscle mass, was significant in the algorithmic approach group. Getting some background noise. So coming to the in terms of number of febrile neutropenia episodes, mortality, mucositis wasn't different, except that the patient who received the algorithmic approach had required lesser platelet transfusion. Next part of supportive care which I'd like to discuss is quality of life. There are various pediatric quality of life scales available in the US and Europe. There are no pediatric quality of life questionnaires from India on Indian patients which are validated. And we recently published our own quality of life validated tool for use in pediatric patients between 10 to 17 years. This is in English in CRSG journal. And we hope that this would stimulate others to get these QOL tools in regional languages and we can implement this in our own practice rather than using Western scales. And this was a large study, had included 264 patients, and extensive piloting and face validity was done. Another important but very less focused area in children is pain and mucositis. Just because children don't complain about pain and mucositis doesn't mean that we should not give attention to it. This study was published about 3 months back from Dr. Rashna Seth and Jagdish Meena from AIIMS. They looked at ketamine mouthwash in children receiving chemotherapy for several oral mucositis. So they included children between 8 to 18 years. They were randomized between a single dose of ketamine mouthwash, the dose of 4 milligram per ml solution, 1 mg per kg, against a placebo. And this study did not find any benefit of using ketamine mouthwash in terms of reduction in pain, use of rescue medication, or any significant adverse effects. The authors concluded that probably we need to use more frequent doses or higher doses of ketamine. This study was by Dr. Amita and Manas. This was presented, I think, in SEOP 2 years back in the award session. Again, a beautiful study. All of us are ketamine, midazolam doctors, pediatricians. Anesthetists prefer propofol, but not many of us have access to anesthetists. So they compared ketamine and midazolam versus propofol for intravenous sedation for getting intrathecal chemotherapy in children with cancer. This study showed that ketamine and midazolam is safer and more effective than propofol. Although propofol acts faster and recovery is faster, but it has very poor efficacy. So this gives us a lot of confidence in using ketamine and midazolam in various settings. I think this was a wonderful study. Another area where India has contributed very big is outpatient treatment in febrile neutropenia. We have very limited beds. Some centers have only, see hundreds of patients, but have only 6 or 7 beds for patients. So we had to develop our own strategy for dealing patients, treating patients as outpatient and treating febrile neutropenias as outpatient. The DALFIN study was presented in SEOP by Dr. Bakshi's group last year in the award session. And there they looked at low risk febrile neutropenias, that is usually solid tumors who would recover their counts fast, to see whether it's feasible to continue antibiotics even after the fever has resolved till the counts recover, or you can stop the antibiotics. And this study clearly showed that if you stop the antibiotics, majority of the time the fever doesn't come back and readmissions are not required. So it's safe to stop antibiotics once the patients become afebrile in low risk febrile neutropenia. Dr. Bakshi's group also did a study where they looked at giving ADE as an induction regimen in an outpatient. Now, this is a bit scary because we are not, at least in my center, we admit patients for even ALL for induction. But this brave strategy worked and they were successfully able to give ADE as an outpatient basis. And this kind of gives confidence to many centers where it's very difficult to admit patients to give chemotherapy. But it's important to remember that they have a very good follow-up. Patients are seen morning, evening in the emergency by a dedicated team. If you don't have this setting, you should not be doing this kind of practice. A study almost a decade back when I was doing my residency at AIIMS by Dr. Bakshi, this was again for low-risk febrile neutropenia. The question was, do you need to give them IV chemotherapy and oral chemotherapy? And the study showed that oral chemotherapy with amoxicillin was as good as IV ceftriaxone for treating low-risk febrile neutropenia as an outpatient basis. Another study from Dr. Rashna's and Dr. Meena's group. I also like this study because so far I've been talking to you about high-risk, low-risk febrile neutropenia. Here they looked at giving IV antibiotics on an OP basis for high-risk febrile neutropenia. So patients who were high-risk febrile neutropenia but were stable, that is they didn't have any shock, were given IV antibiotics on an outpatient basis. And almost 86% in the study received IV antibiotics as outpatient basis. The patients who were sick were admitted. 2 patients in the study died. And they concluded that patients who are not severely ill can be successfully treated even with high-risk febrile neutropenia on an outpatient basis, provided you select your patients carefully. We also did a study about 3 years back, and when we started looking at our stool multi-drug resistant bacteria colonization, we were surprised to find that almost 50% of patients at admission for acute leukemia had MDR bacteria in their stools. And MDR colonization was associated with an increased positivity of blood cultures and mortality in our cohort of patients. So therefore, currently we are practicing an antibiotic de-escalation strategy. So if you have MDR colonized and if you are having neutropenia and fever, we start off with colistin, and then de-escalate fast within 72 hours if the cultures are negative. So our findings have been corroborated by studies from Tata Memorial Hospital as well. Ototoxicity is something which we...
Last 2 minutes.
Last 2 slides only. So this was an elegant study from NEGM. Again, there have been a lot of talks in our discussion in the groups about use of sodium thiosulfate and availability, and sodium thiosulfate was associated with lower cisplatin induced hearing loss, but it's currently not available for us. Thromboembolism, TMH, Dr. Gaurav Narula's group presented this elegant study in the award session, the pediatric cancer associated thrombosis. This is one of the largest thromboembolism prospective registry in the world. And they found out the incidence of thromboembolism was 2.4% in the cohort of 6,000 odd patients. Age more than 10 years, acute leukemia, lymphoma, and TALL were associated with increased risk. Thromboembolism was associated with poor EFS, but not OS, although the EFS OS was also low. I think this was an amazing study. So to conclude, supportive care is a vast topic. Everything supportive care touches every aspect of a child's life. We have excellent data from India. If you could see, 99% of all the studies which I presented are from India, and they are path-breaking, and they have changed practice across the world. So now the time has come to start our own supportive care guidelines. Just like ASCO and COG has guidelines, we should start having INPOC guidelines using our own randomized trial data and our own studies presented from all the INPOC cohort. And we need to encourage more research in supportive care, because it's much more easier to do compared to your drug trials with newer CAR T cells or your antibodies. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Excellent for keeping such a vast topic so concise and also highlighting the Indian scenario. And what was interesting is every time I would put a question over there, you would follow it with the answer without me asking the question. So you clearly were preempting all the things that are coming. There are a couple of points in the chat box. Maybe we can start with them. So Manas asks, is fosaprepitant safe with hydrometotrexate? Because some patients of hydrometotrexate do have a significant amount of chemotherapy-induced nausea, vomiting.
Yeah, it's perfectly safe. In our FOSA study, I think almost 20-30% of patients got hydrocentrics. So we routinely use FOSA with hydrocentrics. There's no issue. Actually, we use FOSA for all our patients who get moderate or highly hematogenic chemotherapy. It's a very safe drug.
And the second question is by Vasudha, which is the role of G-CSF prophylaxis, either as a primary prophylaxis or a secondary prophylaxis in patients with leukemia.
So I didn't go there towards G-CSF prophylaxis. It's a highly debated topic, but we most of the centers do not use G-CSF during induction. But we use once the patient is in remission, both in AML and ALL, because there is always this doubt that, you know, the blast might increase. But when you're using something like FLAG, you actually use G-CSF to bring the blast out. So I think it's a contentious topic. There's no evidence to say that G-CSF worsens or improves. Probably it reduces the days of hospitalization, but it doesn't improve the outcomes.
Maya, you want to ask something?
No, I just wanted to add to what Venkat said. So generally, I think in leukemia induction, most people don't like to give growth factors, and it's usually given probably after AML consolidation prophylactically. But really, there are no other indications for giving prophylactic G-CSF in leukemias. And there is, of course, this cutoff of more than 20% incidence of grade 2 and above neutropenia. So I think we should just stick to that. And there was actually a randomized control study about giving G-CSF and febrile neutropenia in G-CSF versus no G-CSF and febrile neutropenia. And this was done at Tata a few years ago. And it's unfortunately not published. It was written by, done by Dr. Brijesh Arora. And what he found was that there was indeed a decrease in, I think, probably around 2 days fewer admission days in those who received G-CSF, but the mortality and was comparable in both.
Yeah, I wanted to add, Venkat, 2-3 things more. One is, you know, completely endorse your suggestion of you and Samir and Maya and others who should bring Indian-centric supportive care guidelines. The volume of work which you have shown, original work, and with the global work which Lilian Sung and everybody else is doing, we could easily start now building locally adapted supportive care guidelines, which would then inform future research. So please take that forward. That would be an excellent idea. I have a couple of questions. One is a straightforward question, which is about the quality of life tool which you showed. What language was it? Was it in Tamil or was it in English or
English, English. I mentioned that it's English. So I said you have to adapt it for other local languages, so maybe somebody can take the initiative.
The other question which I have, which Maya can also chip in, is about this metronomic therapy. As you know, there are these many the drugs which form a cocktail, and people tweak them for CNS tumors and for solid tumors and for sarcomas. To your experience and understanding, what would currently be an appropriate regimen for, say, a CNS tumor or a sarcoma? I'm not talking about leukemias, but at least for solid tumors, when you would have to use these metronomic therapies.
So I think we at Tata use metronomic chemotherapy quite a bit, and really the endpoint, I think the effectiveness is, it really needs to be defined, the endpoint which you're using to evaluate effectiveness. So PFS will or DFS is definitely not going to be the good endpoint. It's as in the disease is not really going to go into remission. It's very unlikely that a progressive or a relapsed malignancy is going to completely go into a remission just by using metronomic chemotherapy. That's rare. What we generally use it for is to give a good quality of life and to improve the overall survival, where it works a lot. So we haven't got any really good publications. We've not done any randomized trial, but this is just from experience that it generally kind of brings a very partial remission, and it does improve the symptoms. It prolongs the overall survival. That's mainly in the solid tumors where we use a combination of cyclophosphamide, etoposide, and celecoxib. So celecoxib is anti-angiogenic, and it has that. The other thing I think, Raman, you probably are talking about the combat metronomic chemotherapy, which we have been using in relapsed brain tumor. It does, our study showed that there was around, I think there was close to 20% progression-free survival at 2 years when we gave this combat metronomic chemotherapy, which has been used even in solid tumors, which, and every component of that, which is two anti-neoplastic agents, which are temozolomide and etoposide. Then there's valproate, which is anti-angiogenic NNH-TEC inhibitor, and there is isotretinoin, which is a differentiating agent. So all these things together, I mean, again, it's nobody is going to get cured with this. It's just going to be an improvement in overall survival and improvement in quality of life and symptoms.
And maybe this is another topic where India can answer questions for the rest of the world, which is, how to tweak and optimize metronomic therapy. I know Samir has published some data on that.
So there is quite a lot of data from the adult medical oncology colleagues from Tata, in which they have done the same kind of thing. And again, I think they also always their endpoints are different because they always look at the overall survival there, because they just want a few more months. It's not like us having long-term survivals and less late effects and all that. It's a different thing that they look at altogether.
There are no questions in the chat box. Any other comments from any of the panelists? Venkat, you want to add something?
I just wanted to know what everyone thought of the nootropenic diet. I saw Dr. Venkat's comment. I mean, he had done a small Google survey as well. But I still continue to see that a lot of people, medical and pediatric oncologists, do recommend the nootropenic diet. So, what is the, I mean, is there like a consensus, or is there like, what are your thoughts about it?
Can I take this question?
Yes.
Thank you. We have just completed a trial on nootropenic diet in patients with acute leukemia. I've just analyzed the results, not yet been published. So we didn't see any difference in terms of major infections or mortalities or remission rates between a nootropenic diet and a non-nootropenic diet. And this is what has been reported from West as well. But we have to use what is called as a food safety diet, in the terms that you have to have cooked food, make sure that the hygiene is maintained and it's fresh. And even if you're eating fruits, peel them and eat them. So as long as that, if you have a food safety, if you follow the standard food safety diet, avoid raw meat, raw eggs, I think that should be fine. We should not be, restricting the diet severely in children with cancer. And now, hopefully, within a year, we should get the paper out.
Thank you, Dr. Venkat.
Thank you.
I think there are no more questions. So I would like to thank Dr. Venkat for giving an amazing session, and Dr. Raman and Dr. Maya for chairing the session. Thank you very much for all your valuable inputs. With this, we end the pediatric session of the ISMPOCon 2020. Thank you very much to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to put the pediatric session together. Thanks again to all the speakers and the chairpersons. It was a very, very wonderful and stimulating session. Looking forward to many more such sessions in the future. Thank you. Have a nice evening, all of you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.